Happy Independence Day. Happy 4th of July. It is so good to be back doing this with you. I think out of all the videos that I make every year, this one has got to be my favorite to do with everybody. This one is my all-time favorite. If you're a new subscriber to this channel, maybe you subscribed in the past few months, or maybe you're a fan for a long time and you love the Golden Age series of pipe smoking that I do, you should like my 4th of July special. Because this gives me an opportunity to talk about, every year, annually, a great pivotal moment in the history of the American Revolution. It's America's birthday. We're celebrating Independence Day. And so I always like to talk about something very important that happened from our American Revolution. So this year, we're going to be talking about Henry Knox and the noble train of artillery, which is why I'm smoking this pipe today. This is my, this is like a moonshine pipe by Briarworks. And this is called their Cannonball. Henry Knox is our commander of the artillery in the American Revolution. So that's why I'm smoking this pipe. So I got the Cannonball, and I am smoking some First Amendment. Man, I was a sucker for this tin as soon as I saw the can. I had to have, I had to have that can for the 4th of July. And it's nice. It's like perfect for a barbecue. Got the American nutty, burly flavor, but you got the smokiness of the Latakia, which is nice for a barbecue this time of year. And I'm tamping with this. Oh, this is so cool. My cannon tamper. And I got that from Mr. Larry Blackett over at Buttons for Your Britches. The cool thing about this tamper is when you're done using it, you just set it back into the carriage. And it holds your tamper. How cool is that? Okay, very neat. And it's got a little companion, the cannonballs that go with it, which makes a nice tamper too. So thank you very much, Larry Blackett. Okay. So there's no time to lose. This is my Independence Day special, my annual special, and thank you for coming back. I do appreciate it. So let's get into Henry Knox and the noble train of artillery. So let's look at some background. I'm actually going to take this off. This hat weighs a ton and it's very hot. All right. Thank you for bearing with me with that. Okay. So let's talk a little bit of background here. In April of 1775, General Thomas Gage, he's the commander-in-chief, or excuse me, he's the commander of all British forces in North America, and gets wind that the Patriots have, they've got their eyes set on a weapons stash just outside of Boston, a weapons cache. And he wants to make sure that those weapons do not fall into the hands of the Patriots. So he dispatches a force to march to Concord and make sure that the Patriots don't get their hands on this stuff. And of course, Patriots do get wind of that, and they send Paul Revere out on his famous midnight ride. And he's riding around to the countryside all night telling the people, to arms, to arms, to arms. The regulars are marching. The regulars are marching on Concord. To arms, to arms. And who responds to this call? Well, the Minutemen. And the Minutemen get to Lexington. They get all the supplies that they needed out of there. And of course, they wait for the British on the green. Now, we don't know who fired that famous first shot, but when Major Pitcairn and the British arrive, he demands, oh, by order of the king, I order you to lay down your arms and disperse, you rabble. Disperse, lay down your arms and disperse. And somebody takes that famous first shot of the American Revolution. And the war officially begins there. So the British are basically beaten all the way back to Boston in an embarrassment. But the city of Boston itself is a huge British stronghold. I mean, it is a heavily defended city. And of course, the British fleet is in the harbor, all their ships, their warships. So they are Boston is a very powerful hub of British power. So not long after this happens, The Patriots want to strike a blow, but they can't attack the city of Boston. To do that would kind of be suicide. They can't do a frontal assault against British troops against their fortifications in the town of Boston. So they start digging in on the heights just outside of the city. We'll let the British come to us, per se. And so they dig in on top of hills like Breed's Hill and Bunker Hill. And when the British attack up those hills, they just get massacred, they get slaughtered. The famous command was given to the Patriots, men, don't fire until you see the whites of their eyes. So when the British advance up Breed's Hill, that third time they had gotten just decimated the previous time. So that third time they drop their packs, they drop all their excess equipment so they're nice and light, bayonets are gleaming in the sun, and they charge up that hill. And they drive the Patriots off. And it's not a good retreat at all. The Patriots are in full retreat. It's like pandemonium. It's like panic. It was very unbecoming of officers and soldiers to retreat this way. There was nothing organized or orderly about it. So if Washington had been there, he would have been furious about the retreat and how it was handled by the officers. Many of the officers displayed very cowardly behavior in the retreat off of Breed's Hill. And that included his officers of artillery. Now, Washington's not at Bunker Hill because he's at the Continental Congress representing Virginia. And I love this. When Washington shows up to that Continental Congress, he's wearing a new army uniform for an army that didn't exist yet, you know. And he's like, oh, hey, do you notice me? I'm sitting here with my uniform on. Hello. Hi. I'm ready to command an army. It would be like
showing up to a Bulls or a Lakers tryout, and you're not even on the team yet, but you're wearing your team jersey and outfitted with your number and your name on the back.
So he's there, and of course, John Adams sees him, and he says, well, I think we need to pick a commander to lead this new Continental Army, as he calls it. So he said, I'd like to recognize the gentleman from Virginia would be a great commander. There's nobody more qualified than Mr. Washington. So he's chosen, and he tells Congress, I will report for duty at Boston immediately. So when he gets there to Boston, Washington is beyond upset. He can't even believe his eyes of how much of a rabble his new army is. He calls a few privates over and says, let me see inside of your shooting pouches. I want to see what you have. Some of these guys have maybe two or three shots, and so they have almost no ammo. They have almost no powder. He notices most of them and have civilian weapons. They don't even have a musket that would take a bayonet, and that is essential at this time. You have to have a musket that would take a bayonet. He also notices that the men are urinating and defecating anywhere they please. There's not even military bathrooms set up that are dug away from camp. So the sanitary conditions are horrendous. He's also giving orders to troops and to officers that are basically like, well, who are you? I don't follow you. I don't do as you say. I do what they say. And we're going to have a meeting about what you said, and then we'll determine if we're going to follow your orders. So he cannot believe how hard-headed and ignorant and just non-compliant these Yankee New Englanders are. Very off-putting to him. He famously writes in a letter shortly after he's in Boston. He says, if I would have known that this was going to be this way, I would have joined the ranks and taken a musket upon my shoulder. He also says, I would have been better off living out the rest of my days in the backcountry in a wigwam off the grid. So Washington is very, very, he knows exactly the situation he's in, and it's desperate. A commander walking into a situation like that would be very put off by what they would have found at that camp in Boston. So it's at this time, it's like in September of 1775, is when he comes across a young man in the artillery, 25-year-old Henry Knox. He's about the same height as George Washington, but
He's a fat guy. So he's pretty rotund. He's kind of a fat fella for his time. And he meets Henry Knox, and he's impressed with this guy. And Henry Knox was never a soldier. He doesn't have any prior military experience. He joined the Continental Artillery. He was in like in a militia before that for artillery, but he doesn't have any real world military experience. He never served in an army. He never went to some type of a military academy. He had no previous experience in the British Army. Everything that he learned was from books, because Henry Knox was a bookseller in Boston. He owned a bookstore for a living. And Washington just sees something in this guy. He's impressed with his ambition and his intelligence. And he knows deep down, I think this is the guy I want to lead my Continental Artillery unit. Because the officers that he had, it was reported that they behaved like cowards and just did not display any true leadership in the withdrawal or the retreat off of Breed's Hill. So Washington says, you know, I think this is the guy I want, but I can't make this guy the colonel of the artillery, because if I do, half the army is going to mutiny. He's got all these officers in the military that have way more experience than Henry Knox does. But if he tells them, hey, I got this 25-year-old kid here, and they don't have any military experience, but I'm going to make them the head of my artillery, he knows that a lot of officers are going to quit or resign, and going, oh, I got passed up, and what has he done to even show he's even capable? So Washington needs him to do something to earn that spot. One thing that Boston does not have, one thing the Continental Army does not have, is firepower. The Continental Army, this new group of ragtag farmers, they do not have artillery. And so Washington tells a young 25-year-old Henry Knox, Henry, I need you to go on a special secret mission for me. And Henry Knox is very eager to do it. Yes, General, what can I do? You just tell me, I'll do it. He said, I want you to go 300 miles north of here to Fort Ticonderoga and Fort Crown Point. There's over 200 pieces of cannon there. And I want you to bring back as many as you can. This army needs firepower. And I want you to go get those guns. And Knox thinks he can get this done in a couple weeks. That's the best part about this. He's so young and naive and ambitious. He thinks he's, you know, he's full of piss and vinegar. I could do anything. I could tackle anything. So Knox is like, yes, sir, I'll have him back in, you know, about 2 weeks, roughly, something like that. So Knox then makes the journey with his men up the Hudson River, all the way through Lake George, to the northern tip of Lake George, where Lake George and Lake Champlain meet, and he gets to Ticonderoga. At that point, his men start rounding up tons of oxen, horses, and they start building sledges or sleds, 42 of them to be exact. They're not going to build carts with wheels or anything like that to pull these guns. They're going to wait for it to snow and ice over so that they can drag these guns over the ice, okay, down the Hudson River. So I'm going to read you a quote of when Knox gets to Ticonderoga, and I'm going to read to you a little bit about the guns there. So it says, once he arrived at the fort, Knox selected 59 pieces of artillery to take back to Boston. Most of the artillery pieces were 12-pounder or 18-pounder cannons. For those of you who don't know what that means, that is the weight of the cannonball, the size and weight of the cannonball. So an 18-pounder would have an 18-pound ball coming out of it. Imagine the powder charge you would need behind that to push an 18 or a 24-pound cannonball out. Knox also brought one massive 24-pounder, nicknamed Old Sow, that weighed more than 5,000 pounds, and several high-arching mortar guns that weighed 1 ton each. In total, Henry Knox's noble train of artillery weighed 120,000 pounds, or 60 tons. believable. So Knox, hang on one second. Oh yeah, this is the inventory of the guns. This is great. You want to talk about bringing back firepower? He brings back firepower. This is what he brings back: 2 5 and 7/10 inch Cohorn mortars, 4 4.5 inch Cohorn mortars. For regular mortars in brass, brings back 1 4.5 inch in brass. As far as iron mortars, 1 6.5 inch mortar, 1 10 inch mortar, 1 10 1/4 inch mortar, and 3 13 inch mortars. Brass cannons, 8 3-pounders, 3 6-pounders, 1 18-pounder, 1 24-pounder. That's that old sow, weighed over 5,000 pounds. As far as iron cannons, 6 6-pounders, 4 9-pounders, 10 12-pounders, and 11 18-pounders. 11 18-pounders. Howitzers, he brings back 1 8-inch howitzer and 1 8.5-inch howitzer. So when we're talking inch guns, you're talking that's the diameter of the bore, not the weight of the ball. So those are the two different measurements. All right, so that is what he's going to bring back in his noble train of artillery. And so Knox and his men, they wait for it to snow and ice. The first thing they do is they have to move the guns to the Hudson River. So they get the guns on boats, and they take the boats down Lake George to the southern tip of Lake George, which is known as Sabbath Day Point. And from there, they have to load the sledges with the guns. It takes a half a mile of rope, a half a mile to secure these guns to the sledges. And they're going to proceed on the ice of the Hudson River to pull these guns. And one of the boats, actually, on the way to Sabbath Day Point, sinks up to the gunwales in Lake George. And thank God, they were able to bail it out. And they had to raise the ship, get it up out of the water. But they get it there, and they proceed to make 4 trips across the Hudson River. 4 trips moving the guns. They have to go back, get more. So 4 trips they're going to make dragging the guns across the Hudson. So the journey on land, I'm going to read you this quote, required crossing the Hudson River 4 times. The leader of each sled team carried an axe so that if a cannon fell through the ice, they had to cut the line so it wouldn't drag the oxen and the horses down into the river. Henry Knox himself nearly froze to death while trying to walk through 3 feet of snow in a blizzard. In a letter to Washington, he says, "It is not easy to conceive the difficulties we have had." In December of 1775, Knox writes to Washington. He said, "I have built 42 very strong sleds, and I have been provided 80 yoke of oxen to drag them as far as Springfield," the artillery. And he hoped in 16 or 17 days to be able to present to your excellency a noble train of artillery. So once Knox gets those guns out of the Hudson, by the way, so they're dragging those guns on the Hudson River by Albany, New York. And one of those big 18-pounders goes through the ice at Albany and sinks, and it's lost, you know. So Knox doesn't have enough oxen or horses at that time to pull that gun out of the water. So he goes to the good citizens, the good people of the city of Albany, and he asks them for help. He says, "I've got this gun. We need every gun we can get. Folks, can you help, you know, our patriot cause and help pull this gun out?" So the good people of Albany actually grab the ropes and they pull and tug, and they get that gun raised from the bottom of the Hudson River. And he was so grateful to the citizens of Albany that he named that gun the Albany. So once they get the guns down the Hudson River, it's time for these to go over land now through states like Massachusetts. And they have to go over the Berkshires, okay, the Berkshire Mountains. They had to double team the oxen and the horses to pull the guns not only up the mountainsides, but they had to come down the other sides of these mountains and these hills. And I just can't imagine what that would have been like. They would have had to have, you know, not only pulled them up, but you had to make sure you had enough animal power to lower those guns and that they wouldn't go down so fast that it would drag the oxen and the horses down the hill. So I would say, you know, a 25-year-old kid being able to pull this off, and he's going to get these guns to Washington without losing a single cannon, is a really incredible logistical feat. So he's gone over 300 miles to bring these guns to Washington. And 10 weeks later, okay, he thought he could do it in two, okay? He thought he could do it in two. But in about 10 weeks, it takes Knox and his noble train of artillery to get the guns to Washington. But like I said before, I think, you know, when you're 25 and you're full of piss and vinegar, you think you can accomplish anything. So Knox gets the guns to Washington. And Washington wants most of those guns placed on Dorchester Heights, which was a big high piece of high ground overlooking the city of Boston. And William Howe, he's the British general. He's always constantly using a spyglass to survey the heights that would be an advantage for the Patriots on the outskirts of Boston. And he's constantly looking at the heights, trying to make sure that they don't have an advantage, that the British are still in control of the city of Boston. And one night he looks and there's nothing there. You know, he doesn't see any defensive positions or cannon batteries placed on Dorchester Heights. And the next morning, he uses a spyglass to look at the heights. And he cannot believe his eyes when he looks at Dorchester Heights and sees the guns of Ticonderoga looking right down his throat. He cannot believe it. He's like, oh my God. He's like, these Americans have done more in one night than my army could do in a week or a month. These guys are incredible. He cannot believe that the guns of Ticonderoga are pointed right down his throat. Not only they threaten the city's fortified defenses, not only does the guns of Ticonderoga have full command of the town, but they got full command of the harbor. His ships in the harbor are just sitting ducks, and he can't believe he's in this position. So William Howe knows he has no choice. He has to evacuate all the British forces out of Boston. So the Loyalists, everybody, they're loading as many ships. They're trying to evacuate the city as quickly as possible before those guns open fire on his fleet or his city. So on St. Patrick's Day, 1776, before independence, the British evacuate the town of Boston. So thank God for Henry Knox and his noble train of artillery. So I want to talk about some of the takeaways. Why is this important? Why did I pick this for my annual special for you guys? Well, I would say one of the big successes of this story is that this was a huge embarrassment for the British. Huge. They were basically beaten by a bunch of ragtag farmers, a rabble. This is a huge embarrassment that the British Army, the best professional, disciplined military fighting force on the face of the earth, was forced to evacuate an entire city of one of their own colonies. This is a huge morale booster for the Patriots. This is huge. They needed this desperately. They kind of proved to the world and to themselves, maybe we have what it takes. Maybe we can do this. The other reason why this is important, this should make you proud to be an American, is this. Washington, from the inception of the American military, was not trying to build a military where, you know, if you were going to run a regiment, or maybe you were going to be in charge of a brigade or something like that, that you didn't have to be, you know, from the aristocracy. So you'd like to be a colonel. Well, who was your father? How much money did they have? What class were they from? And there was a lot of militaries in Europe, including the British Army, where in order to advance or in order to be somebody in the military, You had to be from the wealthy or from the aristocrat class. You were not going to be the son of a shoemaker carrying a musket in your shoulder and then being a general or some type of a colonel in the British Army. It was not going to happen. The elite in the British Army ran the, or you know, the elite in British society is who ran the British Army. In Washington, who was really a product of the British colonies and the British military system, he served in the provincial forces during the French and Indian War, wanted nothing more than to be a British officer. He's building this American army, this new Continental Army, loaded with hardheads and undisciplined rabble, and yet he's not trying to make his officers and his officer corps from the elites of the colonies. He's trusting a 25-year-old bookkeeper to basically become the head of his artillery. So it's kind of cool that the beginning of our military was, it wasn't about, well, who was your father? How much money did he have? But rather, what can you do? What actions can you show me that you could prove to me that you're worthy of this job? Not because you bought a commission because your father is, you know, some lord in England, but rather the merits of your character, what you're able to accomplish. That is the birth of the American military, is based on that. And Washington putting together this great team of guys based on what they're capable of. And so I think that's something to be proud of as Americans. And also, Henry Knox himself is going to have a very successful run. Not only is he going to command the Continental Artillery during the American Revolution, but Henry Knox is also going to go on to become our first Secretary of Defense. When Washington becomes president, he picks Henry Knox to be his Secretary of War. And that was basically the equivalent of Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense kind of position at that time. And of course, I wouldn't do that for all the gold in Fort Knox. Well, they named Fort Knox after Henry Knox. So Henry Knox is a really interesting guy, and thank God that he was that ambitious. Thank God he was that ambitious and he was full of piss and vinegar to be able to accomplish something like that. Guys, it's one of the most incredible logistical feats of the entire American Revolution. If you went to like a military academy, you would actually study this one for logistics and how they were able to move things that weighed so much across very difficult terrain, 300 miles of incredibly difficult terrain in horrible winter conditions. So my hat is off to Henry Knox and the Patriots that were able to pull that off and give Washington the win and the success that he needed desperately in Boston. It wasn't long after that success. You have to wonder, you know, would independence had been a thing? Would they have voted for that had they not been as successful as they were in dislodging the British out of Boston? So that concludes this special for this year, guys. You've heard me blab on long enough. It's time for you to get over to your barbecues, to be with your families, and to start enjoying the fireworks and the 4th of July and have a nice libation and and go swimming and all that good stuff that families do on this great American holiday. So everybody have an enjoyable, safe, happy, healthy 4th of July. And until next time, YouTube pipe smokers, I will talk to you soon.